The silence on these streets mimic the roads of America. But this isn't the result of any pandemic. This is the sound of an electric future. Every day, new models are announced. More and more people decide to drive electric, but can we sustain it? Or is there a better option? Let's explore this road and find out together. First, we need to understand why this is even important. Now, a couple of days ago, I planned a trip. Now, it's too close to justify a flight out, but it's just far enough away that we're probably gonna have to drive for a few days. So we need a car that's gonna be our best bet for a fun, reliable car that can get us from point A to point B. And we'll talk about where point B is in a little bit.
My name is Corey Workman. This is my 2022 Rivian R1T. This has 835 horsepower, somewhere in the ballpark of about 900 foot-pounds of torque. 0 to 60 in about 3 seconds, and it will quite literally rip your head off.
All right, are we ready?
Sasha, are you ready?
2 days after I picked up the vehicle, we went on a road trip to Grand Junction from Estes Park. The vehicle has route planning built in, and it's connected to some of the larger networks. So we plugged in the destination to Grand Junction, and on our way over, we stopped once to charge for about 20 minutes. Made it into Grand Junction and had to charge about another 20 minutes once we arrived to Grand Junction.
Okay, so we're putting it in sport mode.
It has a canister-based system that uses pressure on either side. So if you go into a corner and the vehicle detects roll, it high pressure pushes to the outside to stabilize the vehicle. And it can do this quickly and dynamically. Then also when you get off-road, this system can depressurize to allow you for articulation. But then you can put it into a sport mode, go on the road, and it can ride and keep up with sports cars through the canyons because of the way that the air suspension system works.
So how you do launch mode in one of these is foot hard on the brake, pedal all the way to the floor.
By far, this is the best vehicle I've ever owned as far as driving performance and ease of use.
Three.
This is a very high quality vehicle. The fit and finish is very nice.
Two.
I feel like that I've gone electric and I'm probably not going back.
One.
Oh my gosh! Whoa! Oh my god!
My first choice would be a normal combustion engine gas car. Now, they run reliably, they're affordable, and more importantly, they're way easier to fuel on long trips. But for the time being, fluctuating prices make it way more expensive to fuel over an EV. Not to mention, the snacks at these gas stations are ridiculously overpriced. Well, you're gonna charge me $6 for a granola bar? It's not even flavored!
Gas-powered cars, they're, I think, beneficial because of the existing market for them. There's a lot of knowledge with mechanics, a lot of extra parts that already exist. Mm-hmm. So fixing them, working on them, maintaining them is a lot easier than the newer electric cars. It's a good step to take towards minimizing the amount of fossil fuels that we emit with other cars. I think the infrastructure for electric vehicles needs to be a little more developed before electric cars can be an actual practicality, but I like the overall idea.
In 2019, I wrote a paper talking about some of the back-end process that goes into building an electric car. So we're talking about cobalt mining, the process of making batteries, and the slave labor that's behind a lot of it. But we have to think about the current market. And for the current market, consumers aren't really worried about how their car was made. They're more so worried about what happens once they take it off the lot. So we're talking about fuel emissions and fuel costs. Now, electric cars are a bit special. They're not just like combustion engine cars. They don't depend on places like Jerry's oil pump down at the corner. They depend on places like this. This is the Estes Park power plant. It helps to power over 3,000 homes with a daily output of over 2 million kilowatt hours. And because it's a hydro plant, that means that most of that energy is sustainable and comes from rivers we have right here in Estes Park. Cars like the Rivian will only use 135 of those, and that's from 0 to 100%. On a daily basis, you may not even need to charge that much. You may only need to charge about 20% of the battery.
I only charge the vehicle up to about 70% to keep the battery healthy, but I'm only really having to charge every few days.
With a slow and steady rise of car chargers popping up across the nation, and power input for most cars like the Rivian being only 135 kilowatt hours, at least at the current rate and from a consumer perspective, I don't think we're going to run out of power anytime soon.
What we should be worried about is the delivery of that power. Now, I'm talking about chargers like these. Now, typically, an EV owner might have one of these in their house. That means that when they're sleeping, they can charge at night. That means when they're out driving in the day, they won't have to charge. That works, but you have to remember, we're going on a road trip. We are not going to have time to stop at your mom's house. We have to stop at places like these. Now, this is a bit of a problem. Further out to either coast, you might have more charging options. You might be able to find chargers easier. But for most of the US, especially places like here in Colorado, when you run out of charge, you might be stuck.
With police specifically, again, with the infrastructure of electric vehicles, you can't just quickly refuel. It takes a while. And especially in a job where you need your car, it's a tool that you use, you need to be able to refuel it in minutes.
Now, luckily, charging times have gotten better across the board. You know, Corey here told us that he can get his truck at some Electrify America chargers from 10 to 80% in just 30 minutes, which is fantastic, but for the majority of times, chargers are going to be much slower, meaning that by the time you're out of that parking lot and charged up, you might have already had to buy the stupid unflavored granola bar.
Now, if we want to avoid those granola bars, we're gonna need a bigger battery. Now, if you didn't know, electric cars are offered in different configurations. You could think of it as different versions of the iPhone or different trim levels on a Rolls Royce.
I challenge you to find a material in this car that is not cow, sheep, chrome.
Well, the first thing you feel,
yes,
is the stuff under your feet.
It's 3.5 inches of lamb's wool.
It's lamb's wool. 20 lambs died for this rug.
James, you don't have to kill lambs to get wool.
Many EVs come with shorter range models, entry level models. That means the car is cheaper, but you know, the range is smaller, like a Nissan Leaf might only have a range of 100 miles. Now, if you want a bigger battery, which is what it's gonna take to do this road trip, then that means that introduces a new variable. While the Tesla Model S might not have that same Rolls-Royce interior, they do have that starting cost of $96,000.
Excuse me. Do you have reservations here?
No.
All right, so Corey, that was good. So we're just gonna do one more take of you heading down that road that way.
Okay, all right.
And then you can come back and we should be good to go. He's coming back, right? He's supposed to come back.
All right. One, two, three, four.
Even if Corey hadn't left us out here, I don't think the decision would have been any easier. As it is, the future for both combustion engine cars and EVs looks really bright, but for our road trip, I don't think either is gonna work. I just wish there was some third option. You know, some car that had the cleanness and efficiency of an EV, but the affordability and reliability of a gas car, but I just can't think of it.
My name is Mason Wignall. I'm a proud Prius owner, and this is my 2013 Toyota Prius. The car's got a 6-gallon tank.
Wait, do you see that over there? Dude, why did it have to be a Prius owner?
Well, it's either that, we get eaten by a wolf, or we freeze to death, and I would much rather go with that.
That's fair, I guess so.
Miles before I have to refill. So for such a small tank, it's pretty good gas mileage.
All they do is plant trees and drink kombucha.
Dude, you know that's a stereotype, right?
Yeah, I guess so. Wait. Is he talking to himself over there?
Hey,
bud!
Oh, hey, you guys need a ride?
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, welcome, guys.
Hi.
How's
it going?
Where do you want me to put this?
Oh, sorry about that. You can just throw it next to the kombucha bottles.
Yeah, I'll careful up directions, and we should be out of here soon.
Cool.
This is going well.
It's a six, this,
perfect.
Yeah!
Yes! Knew it! That took me 40 tries. I'm not joking.
Lucky, holy crap, no. I cannot. Yeah, I'm like... Sound guys don't talk. Tripods don't move either, so shut up.
This is going in as bloopers.
The camp speaker.
Oh shoot, I forgot about all that stuff. But... Okay, right there. You good? Okay.
Nice.
Shoot, that was like everything I wanted to answer.
I can say them in different segments.
No. Talking about fuel efficiency, fuel cost, and...
That was so perfect! Why did I have to
ruin it? You see that cop looking at us? I'm kidding. Okay. Poggers, is that a Tesla suit?
Yeah, thanks for interviewing me. Hope that helps with your project.
Signing off. Bye.